Hello and welcome to Social Church. We are so excited to be joined by Jay Warner Wallace today. So many of you will know Jay Warner Wallace. He is the cold case homicide detective, as well as being a speaker and author. Jay Warner Wallace is also the creator of the award-winning Casemakers Academy and author of the new book So the Next Generation Will Know. We're so excited to hear this. Over to you, Jay.
Hi, I'm Jay Warner Wallace, and this is my testimony. Although when I use that word testimony, I get asked that question a lot. What is your personal testimony? I'm sometimes hesitant to offer it because I really don't think that my personal testimony matters. And if I'm honest with you, I don't think yours does either. Now, when I say that, I know that can sound off-putting, so give me a second to explain it. I think in the end, what matters is whether or not this thing I accept as true, the Christian worldview, is in fact true. And that's going to be more important than anything. I can tell you, as a person who was not a believer until the age of 35, I was unimpressed with the testimony of the people I knew, because everyone's got a story. And I knew lots of people who were members of lots of different worldviews, and all of them had a testimony. As a matter of fact, that's very, very similar in the sense that if you ask somebody, well, why are you a Muslim? Why are you a Christian? Why are you a Buddhist? You almost always got the same kinds of answers. Number one, I was raised that way. Or number two, I had an experience that demonstrated for me this is true. Well, it turns out everyone's got those two answers, regardless of worldview. So I was largely unimpressed when somebody would offer their personal testimony. But, of course, all of us have a story, and I have a story, too, of how I became a Christian. I was not raised in a Christian setting. I didn't have any Christians in my family. My parents are not Christians. And I just didn't know anybody growing up who lived this life in such a way as they even would speak about it. If there were Christians, I certainly didn't know who they were. Now, when I got to become a police officer, there's a journey you go through in working in a law enforcement career, and I started off in patrol and would work SWAT and gangs and ultimately end up working in an investigative position. And I knew some police officers who were Christians. And they were, I know at least two that were pretty vocal. But if you ask them questions, just push back a little bit, give me some reason to believe this is true evidentially. After all, we are police officers who work cases on the basis of evidence. So if you think you need evidence to make a case against a suspect, can you just give me some reasons, some evidential reasons why I should accept that the Bible's reliable and Christianity is true? And I would always offer objections along the way because I was somebody who was pretty committed to my atheistic worldview. And I was thoughtful about it. And so I would ask these questions. And to be honest, the people I knew who were Christians didn't have very good answers. As a matter of fact, most of the time their answers were pretty lame. And so I thought, well, and of course I did know some Christians who would also talk about their faith. Those are the people we were taking to jail. A large percentage of the people we took to jail would tell us, without even being prompted, that they were Christians. And I used to think, really? So these two groups that I know, the people who are the Christians who can't really explain to me why it's true, and those who say they're Christians but are doing crimes, I was not persuaded by any of it. And so I stayed away from it. And my wife was somebody, though, who was more open. Her experience was different than mine. And so she would occasionally say, well, should we raise up our kids with some kinds of religious beliefs? Or should we not at least expose these? I was willing to go to church just to please her. You know, my dad's the same kind of person. He would be willing to go to church just to please his kids or to please his wife if they want to go to church. He doesn't believe it's true, but it is a useful delusion for a lot of people. They feel like at least it can teach good values, and that was where I stood. So I went to church with my wife because she wanted to go to church, and I wanted to please her. And I remember sitting in a church for the first time, listening to a sermon, and hearing the pastor at this particular day, he mentioned a lot of things about Jesus of Nazareth, but the one that stuck in my head was he said that Jesus was the wisest, smartest person who ever lived. And he actually made a claim that Jesus, the teaching of Jesus of Nazareth, was so transformative that it set the foundation for Western civilization. And I thought, really? So I bought a Bible to see if any of this was true. And as I read through the scriptures, the New Testament Gospels, because I was just trying to mine out the words of Jesus of Nazareth, I was struck by the texture of the Gospel accounts. Because, you know, I worked, by this time, I've been working criminal cases for some time, and it's not unusual to have four or five witnesses who will see a crime and each report it slightly differently. That's very common. And there's a certain range of variation that I would expect between reliable eyewitness accounts. And I started to see that range in the Gospels, and it just provoked me to study them and to test them using something called forensic statement analysis, which is basically a technique, as much an art as it is a discipline, that I used with suspects in my criminal work. And so I did that, particularly with the Gospel of Mark. And after doing this for 6 months and researching all the transmission of the text and how this thing was passed along through history and all the other ways that you might test the accounts, because there's a template, you know, there's a template we use in criminal trials, and I applied that template to the gospel authors, they passed the test. And that really got me thinking. And so within about six or seven months, I guess, I was at a point where I would have said, and I did say to my wife, you know, I think that these accounts are reliable, and they're telling me something I can trust about the person of Jesus. The problem, of course, is they were telling me that Jesus rose out of the grave. And now, of course, if he might be a wise ancient sage, but if he rises out of the grave, he's in an entirely different category. And I knew that. And I knew that at the point where I was, I had belief that the Gospels were telling me the truth, but I was not yet a Christian because I didn't have belief in. And to move from belief that to belief in, I began to read the gospel accounts to see what they said, not about Jesus, but to see what they said about me. And as I read what they said about me, I began to see that they were telling me something true, as true in their descriptions of me as they were in their descriptions of Jesus. And that really, for me, is what made the difference, because when I realized that Jesus claimed to be a savior, and I thought that was a reliable claim, and then realized that I was in need of a savior, these two ideas found a connection in my mind, and I realized that Jesus was, in fact, the savior that I needed. Now, I say today that I'm not a Christian because it works for me, and I'm not. And that's why I don't really care much about personal testimonies. I'm not a Christian because I was trying to fix something that was broken, or because I was trying to have a better life now, or because I was trying to repair my damaged marriage, and I'm not a Christian because I was raised that way. I'm simply a Christian because it's true. And I would much rather live in what is sometimes an inconvenient truth than in a convenient lie. And so I found myself submitting, surrendering. Now, you might be the kind of person who is as skeptical and as reluctant as I was. But if you were to take the time to actually read the Gospels and assess them the way that I did, you would find that they are telling you something true. And more important than the truth they even speak about Jesus, there's a truth about us and our need. And look, we all, if God was just good, we'd be all right, because there's days when I can be good. But there's a category difference between God, it seems to me, and humans. And that category difference separates us from God, because God, being all-powerful, means that he has the power to eliminate imperfection, including moral imperfection. So we don't love a good God. We love a perfect God, a morally perfect God. You might even be able to stand in front of a good God, but none of us can stand in front of a morally perfect God. And you're not going to be able to work yourself into that position. And I realized that. I mean, I knew all my messed up, you know, the aspects of my life that were pretty, you know, messed up. And I knew that I was never going to reach moral perfection. And if I couldn't be in that category based on my own efforts, how else am I going to get there? And that's where I realized that Jesus could make the difference, because I could actually, offers been made to us to exchange our moral imperfection for the moral perfection of Jesus. So we may never become practically perfect, but we can be positionally perfect immediately if we're willing to trust Jesus to do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. So if you're listening to this and you think you're ready to make a decision about where your life is headed, if there is a God and you'd like to know that God personally, the way to do that is to stop working hard, stop trying hard. It's not a matter of things you can do or behaviors you can employ. It's a Savior that you can trust. You have to put your trust in Christ. And that's what you can do right now by simply admitting that you are not God, that you have lots of stuff in your life that you need to be forgiven for. And that forgiveness is available if you're willing to repent of your sin and ask Jesus to do for you what you cannot do for yourself, to stand before God on your behalf. If you're willing to trust him in that capacity to be your Savior, Well, you can do that right now. I'm not even going to. I resisted the idea as a non-Christian, as an atheist, that there was a prayer I could say in a formula that each of us has our own words, and you have your own words that you can say in your heart and mind to admit who you are, to admit your need for a savior, to repent of your life the way it has been, and to submit to God through Jesus as your savior right now. And that will begin for you a journey, just the beginning of a journey. Like starting the investigation, it gets me to a place where I know who my suspect is. Now I've got months and years to make that case in front of a jury. Well, you can make that decision right now for Jesus and spend the rest of your life coming to know him better. That's something I would encourage you to do.
Praise God for these testimonies. Thank you so much. Make sure that you subscribe to our YouTube channel below. We release new testimonies every single week, alongside Q&As, expository preaching, and acoustic worship sessions. Thanks a lot for listening, and see you soon. Bye.